Hello and welcome to a Technology Tuesday from November 2009. Today we're going to be talking about Google Wave. Now, email is old. Email's been around since 1971 when Ray Tomlinson developed a hack to transfer files over ARPANET. This was the network that evolved into what we now call the Internet. He says it took him about 6 hours to create in his spare time. And email has not changed too dramatically over the years. This simplicity may be one of the reasons for its ubiquity. However, email has inherent flaws, such as email promotes the distribution of duplicate attachments rather than sharing from a centralized repository. Email supports limited content types, and email does not scale well with multiple recipients and multiple messages. So there we go. Email isn't fantastic, and email is old. Email is as old as everyone you now see on the screen. It's as old as Bangladesh, Winona Ryder, Kid Rock, and Johnny Knoxville. So what do we do? Well, Google Wave created the question, what would email look like if it were invented today? As such, it's a real-time collaborative tool that assembles the elements of instant message, wikis, Google Docs, and email into one interface. Initially, you may find it a little confusing to use, but Google Wave has the potential to usurp older methods of communication. Now, the inventors of Google Wave, Lars and Jens Rasmussen, also created Google Maps, and they're science fiction geeks. So the Wave name was inspired by the television series Firefly. In Firefly's universe, communication took place via Wave, hence this name. Now, Wave is a protocol, in the same way that HTTP Hypertext Transfer Protocol is a protocol. HTTP allows netizens to create web pages and surf the web. When Tim Berners-Lee gave HTTP and the web to the internet community, this transformed the world and the way we communicate. So perhaps Google Wave may have a similar influence. Google is developing Wave, but this technology is not proprietary. Others can develop the three elements of Google Wave. The protocol, which is Google Wave as an extension to the Extensible Message and Presence Protocol, XMPP. There's the server, and then the client. Now, Google Wave currently runs in the browser, but I imagine dedicated clients could be created shortly. So how do you get on Google Wave? There are two ways to get a Google Wave account, something that looks a little bit like jmoore.depaul@googlewave.com. The first one is you can request an invitation from wave.google.com, or you can ask someone you know on Google Wave for an invitation. Option two is generally the quickest way to get an invitation. Typically, you may have to wait a week for your invitation to come through, and this will be sent from the account wave-noreply@google.com. You may have to check your spam filter to ensure that this message arrives successfully. Google currently recommends three browsers for running Google Wave. They are Google Chrome, Firefox, and with Firefox you're best off installing Google Gears as well, or Safari. Now, Google Gears currently doesn't install on OS X Snow Leopard if you're using Safari. Although it may tell you it doesn't work on mobile devices, you can get it to work on your iPhone. If you ignore the error message that you see on screen, you can sort of get it working on the Palm Pre with a hack to make the browser report as mobile Safari, and then it will run on Android mobile telephones. So what's the interface? Well, Google's Wave's interface is fairly straightforward. It has four primary panes. In the top left-hand corner, we have navigation. Below that, we have contacts. To the right of that, we have an inbox. And to the right of that, we have our conversation pane. Now, Google Wave has an interesting structure. It operates by using wavelets. A wavelet is a container for participants, and each wave has one or more participants who may be humans, so basically those are the normal wave users, or robots. Robots are a form of an extension. They are automated agents that perform a specific function, such as providing poll results or linking usernames to Twitter. And one of your participants can be public. If you add the public at a.gwave.com to Wave, this allows anyone to participate to your Wave. Now, within wavelets, you also have blips. Blips are the individual messages within a wave, and a blip can contain another blip. You also have gadgets. Gadgets are a form of an extension. What they do is they have mini applications that can run within your browser, such as Google Search, the Yes, No, Maybe application, the ability to embed Google Maps, to conference call, to video chat, to plan a trip, to check weather, or to play Sudoku. And then the last thing you can do with your wavelet is you can attach documents. You can attach those two blips within the wavelet. So what are the ramifications? What's the future? Well, Google Wave has just been released. There are some things that may happen. The product may enter history as one of Google's interesting experiments, or it may take off. It might be something that people use. If Google Wave is a success, then some of the possible outcomes are, well, existing email services are replaced by Google Wave, or it could be that users migrate from social networks, that people move from Facebook and MySpace to start using this service, perhaps because they have greater control over their data. Wave could become the new standard for online collaboration. And through doing that, it also might become the new standard for project management, in the way that many of us who manage projects might be using Basecamp. We may choose to move over to Google Wave. And then the thing that's of interest to anyone within academia is the fact that Google Wave might integrate with learning management systems such as Blackboard or Desire to Learn, or indeed actually replace those learning management systems. Google Wave definitely has the capacity to do that. Well, I'm going to end this presentation here. This is the online component to a face-to-face presentation. In the face-to-face presentation, we discussed ways in which Google Wave could be used within the academic environment and then demonstrated Google Wave. I'd like to keep this presentation short, so from here on, I'm going to direct you to some videos that are out there that demonstrate how to use Google Wave, and also some internet resources and books. On the page below the video, you'll see some links that talk about ways that you can discover more about Wave, the Federation Protocol, and the Wave API. There are also two books that are out there at the moment that explain how to use Google Wave. We have Getting Started with Google Wave, which is an O'Reilly publication. And then there's The Complete Guide to Google Wave by Gina Trapani and Adam Pash, which is independently published. It's going to be published in January 2000. But at the moment, you can view a preview and download a PDF from completewaveguide.com. There we go. Thank you. That was an introduction to Google Wave.